Hello everyone, welcome to this course on NPT, which is focusing on rural water resources management. This is a very first course on rural water resource management, and especially here, because there are a lot of need statements for managing water resources in India, especially. So I am Professor Penin Chinnaswamy from Center for Technology Alternatives for Rural Areas, located in Indian Institute of Technology, Bombay. It's a very unique department only focusing on rural areas and finding new technologies and science for better application in rural regions. So the first week of the lecture would happen from today. And the first lecture would be on trying to sensitize the topic, why this topic is needed, and what would be covered in the 12 weeks from now. I would be using a lot of my personal experiences as a hydrologist, for which I would like to go into my personal introduction. I have graduate degrees, double masters in physics, so it's helped me a lot to understand the physics behind water management, the physics behind. And my PhD was focusing on surface water, groundwater, and hydrology of both these two systems and interactions between them. Also, I looked into nutrient dynamics, microclimate, and to map all these, I learned GIS and remote sensing. Sometimes a good understanding of hydrology running hydrological models, and where there's no data, and if you'd like to see some different scenarios, hydrological models are used. In this course, we'll be focusing most on what I did for my PhD in hydrology for water management. My research profile after my PhD, I moved in as a postdoctoral fellow for Ashoka Research in Ecology and Environment in Bangalore. Then I was in a researcher for International Water Management Institute in Sri Lanka, where I focused on groundwater, remote sensing, and water budgets, which we'll be covering through this lecture. And also I looked at a lot of climate change scenarios and adaptation and mitigation to climate change. These are really, really important terms, at least in the current scenario in India, where climate change extremes are happening. And we need to know how to adapt, mitigate, and preserve and conserve the water resources. Then I was as a senior researcher in Nanyang Technological University, Singapore, where I did some flood prediction models and also ran some climate change scenarios. I'm currently also a visiting scientist with NM Sadhguru Foundation in Dahod, Gujarat, and also a visiting professor in University of Oulu, Finland. This is a general overview of my personal curriculum or CV and what I have come across to teach in this rural water resource management. From my introduction, I would like to also introduce my team. That would be guiding you through the course. They would also be on communication through the networks that have been given to you. The first TA would be Mr. Pranath, who is also my PhD student at SITA. He has a policy social science background from TIS, and he's also a hydrologist and a GIS remote sensing person. His research is on lake restorations and rural lakes in India. Second TA would be Mr. Muhammad Qasim Khan. He is a technocrat. He is more into IT. And since we are getting a lot of data for rural water management, his research area focuses on how to manage these water resources using big data, IoT, ICT tools. some of them would come across this lectures, but most importantly, these two people or TAs would be helping you throughout the course. The other things which are much more important than the lectures and the TAs would be the books. And you'll be following most of these books in the lectures. I'll give you the citations where I'll be using them. The first book would be the groundwater book from Professor Fries and Cherry. Fries is a pretty well-known person across the world for groundwater. And this book has been used as the dominant resource for anything regarding the groundwater. And since this course focuses on rural water resource management, groundwater is key, groundwater management is key for the course. So we'll be going through this book a lot. Next book would be Principles of Phytology. We'll be using these books to understand some biological principles and how these react in the field can be taken up by physical hydrology from Dingman. Most of the information I have taken and put in the lectures. So if you do not have access to the books, you could still follow through the lectures for your homeworks, for your and other aspects in exams and etc. You'll also be using introduction to hydrology. All these are kind of introduction or 101 courses for hydrology, water resource management. And then a little bit of groundwater aspects would come from books like Hydrogeology from. So these books are pretty well known across international forums. Coming to the Indian hydrology and a lot of Indian material, I've used Professor Raghunath's book, Hydrology Principle Analysis and Design. So this book has been widely cited and it has a lot of information on the local Indian region about hydrology, the water budgets, what kind of systems have been used in India, the traditional methods, and a lot of equations for civil engineers to estimate the hydrological components. Along with this, I would also be sharing information from my field notes. Again, as I showed in my personal introduction, even though I am a hydrologist and modeling and GIS person, I've done more work on the ground. So a lot of field experiences, field notes from my work in the rural region, and also work from NGOs would be used here. Because a lot of the work from NGOs, non-governmental organizations, do not end up as books and papers. Either they don't have time or it is not a mandate for them to write these. So these end up as documents, and these documents I would be using or documentary videos, etc. So these materials I'd be using across the lectures so that you can understand from a ground person, the NGOs work on the ground, how they manage these water resources sustainably. So let us move to the course introduction and topics to be covered. As I said, why is this course important? It is because the importance put on water resources. Water has been and is the most important resource for living organisms. One of the reasons why people go in search of water for other plants is because it is the driving force. So it is a very important source, and especially for rural regions where livelihoods are dependent on water. Cities, maybe it is not. It is only for domestic use. But when you go to rural regions, water resources are key for livelihoods also. The importance in India, we'll be covering this, and this is where this course is very important. India is still an agrarian nation, which means most of the livelihood is either directly or indirectly related to agriculture. And since agriculture happens in rural villages, most of it, we are looking at how to manage rural water resources. As I said, the focus would be mostly on rural India, and Some examples would come from like rainwater harvesting, might come from cities and other perspectives, but most of these lectures would be. With this, I would like to go into what we'll be covering per week. And in the first week, we'll be looking at the course introduction, which is going through by week topics. This builds the interest on why to understand or go through this lectures and what to expect at the end of the lectures. So I'll be breaking up the lectures into modules. Explained today in this lecture, and you could build an expectation on what to expect and also what notes you need to refer. Most importantly, we'll be looking into the hydrological cycle. This is the key for understanding water management, and we'll be covering that in the first week. As promised, we'd look at what you could expect for the weeks to come. Week one would be discussing about importance of water resource management in India, which is why do you need to have water resource management in India in scenarios both in urban and rural setting? Why is the importance much more needed now, especially in climate? COP26 scenarios. Then we would go into the introduction of the hydrological cycle, which is the base for understanding the water resources in any region, be it urban or rural. Any region, you need to understand the hydrological cycle and how they are represented. So this would be gone through in detail in week one. Please understand that there are multiple components in the hydrological cycle, what makes the hydrology, but we only focus on the most important ones due to the length of the course and what is important for rural water management in India. I divided based on the need for rural water management and also based on the course structure. I've divided the next 2 weeks meeting and discussing the key hydrological parameters. So we would have a set of 5 to 6 parameters in week one. And then in week three, we would go into more on the hydrological parameters, the more important ones. The first week or the second week, we would go through some basic hydrological parameters, which would lead into the secondary or more important hydrological parameters in week. Week four would go into introduction to groundwater hydrology. So this is a little bit different from the hydrological cycle. The hydrological cycle would encompass the entire hydrology at a given location, not only the groundwater, but when we zoom into the groundwater hydrology, we would get into much more complex components, which may not be represented in the overall hydrological cycle. One of the things is like infiltration, percolation, etc. Why this is important to understand is because it gives a more better understanding of rural water management. Most of rural India is still dependent on groundwater for irrigation. So it is very important to understand the groundwater hydrology for the rural setting. So hydrology is the movement of water, the study of the movement of water. And the first couple of weeks, we'll be looking at the overall hydrological cycle. And then we'll be focusing very, very narrowing down to the rural scale. And that is where groundwater hydrology becomes important, which would be covered in week four. Moving on, once we introduce the groundwater hydrology in week four, we would also introduce the multiple variables, parameters in the hydrological cycle. And then from there, we would discuss in detail some groundwater components. This is important again to understand water resource management, because if you do not understand which components are key or are bigger storage components in the cycle, then your efforts in water resource management would go, the benefits would go somewhere else, not to the local area that you want to focus. So it is very important to understand the groundwater components. Moving on, we would also look at some of the surface water hydrology components. So those who know hydrology or water resources, there are two types of water resources. One, two major types. So one is your surface water, which you could see on top of dams, lakes, rivers, streams, etc. And the other component is the groundwater cycle, where it goes under the ground and a lot of complex processes happen. So week 6 would lead into the surface water hydrology components, because we would also want to touch upon some of the basic hydrological components for surface water hydrology. But most, as I said, most importantly, we would look into groundwater. The water mass balance equation with a rural focus. So this is like a budget. The water mass balance equation would give you the budget on how water comes into the rural system. What are the key drivers that bring the water into the system? The second is how water is extracted or taken up by the system, multiple activities, farming, livelihoods, etc. Then the next components would look at what is remaining in the system so that you could preserve water in the rural setting. So a water mass balance is kind of a budget to show how much water comes in, how much is used, and how much remains. If you go on a negative budget, or if you overspend, then what happens is you will be taking water from the already stored water resources, which is going to deplete your long-term water sustainability. So that is what we'll be discussing in week 7. In week 8, we would be looking at rural water management issues. So what are the current issues? What are the more key issues for water management in India? And we would look at more specifically data challenges, observation records, etc., etc., so that we could understand if we need to better, where do we need to focus more. So that is where we would be doing a lot of insights in week 8. If you look at it, we are starting from the introduction of the hydrological cycle, then going into the components. Once you know the components, then you're fitting them into a water mass balance equation budget. Once the budget is prepared, you are better to understand the rural water management issues. The data challenges are also discussed, because it is as and more important once you know the budgets, the water budgets, and the key components for rural water management. What are the data that you have to actually conduct these management activities? So that's where we get into some of the data challenges for rural India and look at how observation records are being made. Then we would also go into rural water resource management structures. So how are these infrastructures built? What are their lifelong achievements? What are the pros and cons in most of the rural water management infrastructures that are used? So I've divided it into two components. In week 9, you'll be looking at engineered rural water resource management infrastructures, which are some examples like dams, check dams, where you need to engineer or bring some concrete structures into practice. So that is what you'll be discussing in week 9, engineered options, engineered solutions for rural water management. Week 10, you would be looking at rural water resource management infrastructure, nature-based. So what is the difference between these 2 weeks is you would be looking at an engineered perspective and where a lot of money has to be spent. Big projects are being made in engineered Whereas in nature-based solutions, it is on and along with nature. How do you bring already existing traditional knowledge and lessons from nature to preserve water in a rural setting? Also, how do you look at these two approaches from a centralized version, which is at a top-down approach we call, where you have a big, massive structure catering to many people, or multiple smaller structures catering to multiple people? So this is where you would be discussing in detail both engineered and nature-based solutions. The nature-based solutions are very important nowadays because engineered solutions have become more expensive, very costly to manage also. So once it is expensive to create and also expensive to manage, and land is being very, very less. So slowly nature-based solutions are coming up, and we would jump into some of these, introduce some of these topics and concepts in the lecture. In week 11, we will be looking at some case studies for rural water resource management. As I said, I would bring some case studies from my field experience. I'd be in a better position to explain what has happened in the field, why did the project go, and why the different outcomes and results came up. So some of my case studies would be discussed, but more importantly, case studies from non-government organizations, extension networks, government agencies would be discussed. So these would give you a bird's eye view of how some people have used science to understand rural resource water management and have been successful. Also, to understand week 9 and 10, the basic difference would be also engineered is more on the engineering cycle, whereas nature-based solutions would be on scientific cycle. So both of these would be discussed as solutions, options for solutions in week 11. There's not one right way. It depends on where you are on the rural setting. So you would see a mix of engineered and nature-based solutions in week 11. In week 12, for those who are very interested to take up the understanding from this course and solve the rural water problems in your area or your nearby areas, I will be going through some databases that would help you, put you on the track to first estimate the rural water budgets. And from the rural water budgets, you would understand the hydrological cycle. And once you understand the hydrological cycle, you would be in a better position to come to week 9 and 10 to see what kind of solutions can you give. So everything starts with the database to understand if there is a problem, there is a water resource problem in rural India. And from there, what are the analysis you want to do is being done through the hydrological models, algorithms, or budgets. And those understanding and information you would convert into a solution, which are being covered in week 9 to 11. So with this, I would stop the first lecture, and all the details for the courses, the documents and everything have been shared with you. The TA details are also there for communication. So we would close, and we would take up the next course looking at the hydrological cycle coming soon. Thank you.